David said in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. Mary said in Luke 1, God, my Savior, not a Savior, not the Savior, my Savior. Is Christ your Savior? Do you know Him? Bibles, you can turn to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. Just glad I didn't trip over that wire coming out here with this table. Never know. So we've been in Luke. We're continuing through Luke, and we're coming to today. We'll be focused this morning on verse 8 through 15, and then tonight we'll take 15 to 20 and finish this section. So this is probably the most well-known chapter in the Bible in the world, is this chapter on the birth of Christ and the angels coming and these things. So if you think about Christmas, when we started Luke, we mentioned this, that Christmas, the word, is Christ Mass. It comes from Catholicism, and back many, many years ago, the Bishop of Jerusalem, he asked the Bishop of Rome about the birth of Jesus, when it was, and nobody really knows. We looked at that last week in the first part of chapter 2, when this census was taken, was about 8 BC, and then it took 2 to 4 years for that to come into effect. So around between 6 and 4 BC is when Christ was born. But when the Bishop of Jerusalem asked the Bishop of Rome about Jesus' birth, he didn't know, and so he decided to make December 25th the day of celebrating Christ's birth. He did that to combat pagan worship, because it was a high day of pagan worship. And there's some other things that go into December that aren't with pagan worship with that date, but that's for another message. But his thought, the Bishop of Rome, was, well, there's all this pagan worship in the world, and so let's take the birth of Jesus, the incarnation, and let's use that to try to get people's focus to be on Christ and off of this pagan religion. But then Constantine took over Rome, and when Constantine took over Rome, he brought religious freedom for the Christians, and what ended up happening was all the pagan religions were dumped into Christianity and Christmas. And so there's a lot of things that got dumped into there. We could take a lot of time and look at all those, but again, that's for another time. But what happened was, it was, you know, the thought was a good thought. You know, this is a time when pagans are all this worship, and let's try to focus people on Christ. Let's try to use it for people to hear about Christ. But what happened with Constantine was a lot of pagan worship got dumped into Christianity and Christmas. And a lot of what we see today in America, around the world, it has a tie back to some of those pagan religions. But here's the thing. We can't be legalistic about some of these things. You know, you hear things with greenery and candles and all these things that you could tie to pagan worship way back then. But here's the thing. God created all things, correct? God created greenery. And the worship of Christ coming, the celebration of Christ coming, happened way before any pagan religions. Because in Genesis 3:15, if we look at that, this was after Adam and Eve sinned. I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. When Adam and Eve sinned, and sin entered into the world, the wages of sin is death. God could have immediately killed Adam and Eve. He allowed them to live, but what he did was, in Genesis 3 here, he immediately brought into the plan that he already knew was going to happen, but he brought this in showing Adam and Eve mercy. He brought in that Christ, the Messiah, would come and he would die for the sins of the world. The serpent, which is Satan, would bruise his heel. That speaks of the crucifixion. And then the Messiah would crush the head of the serpent and destroy Satan, destroy death, the power of Satan and death. We see that in Hebrews 2:14, that the power of death and the power of Satan were destroyed by Christ. So as we think about the incarnation, in Micah 5:2, we looked at this last week, but as for you, Bethlehem Ephratah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you will one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. This is another prophecy over 700 years before the time that we're looking at here in Luke 2, that was prophesied that Messiah would come and be born in Bethlehem, the city of David. And so that's what we looked at a lot, how that happened and all that went into Mary and Joseph being in Bethlehem at the time that Jesus would actually be born. But as we think about Christmas and, you know, there's a lot of the things with, you know, some people don't celebrate Christmas because of, you know, the tie with paganism and things, and that's fine if people want to do that. But what I want you, as we begin today, to realize what we're celebrating today and tomorrow with Christ coming to earth has nothing to do with pagan religion. It has been prophesied, it has been celebrated for thousands of years, that God, at the beginning, instead of killing Adam and Eve, he showed them mercy, but he enacted the plan of salvation through Messiah. At the beginning, all through the history of Israel, they looked to the one who would come, the Messiah who would come and save them from their sins and set them free from their enemies. And so what we're doing is, you know, we're taking a day and we take a time of year where we go back and we focus and we try to look again at what God did in sending his son to save us from our sins. You know, and if you have a tree in your house, I have a tree in my house with lights on it, and my tree points to the Lord. It's an evergreen, has lights. Christ is the light of the world. You know, it's not wrong to have those things if you're using those for the Lord. Where we get into the weeds is when we begin to take some of the pagan stuff and actually do some of that stuff. That's not good. That's not what Christmas is about. We are here to worship Christ, to praise God for his mercy on us. And so what you're doing today, I'm sure many of you have probably heard that with the pagan religion and all that. We are joining in something that has been celebrated since the beginning of time, of man being on the earth. We're continuing that and praising God for what he has done. So has anybody been stressed out and really anxious besides me the last couple of weeks? I was thinking the last couple of days, like, I got to a place I was like, I'm just ready for this to be over. I'm so stressed and anxious that there's so much going on and there's so much to do. And then you got other, this life things that are happening in the midst of all the other things. You know, and as I was studying this week for this message, it just kept coming back to me that Christ, that where the angel tells the shepherds, for today in the city of David, there's been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Has anybody seen the movie Elf? Anybody watch that? I like to watch that every Christmas. That just, it cracked. You know, it's a good movie if you can see it so many times and it still makes you laugh, right? But think about Buddy the Elf. He's in New York, and how did everybody look at him? This guy is nuts, right? Like, he is so weird. And why in the world he's so excited about Christmas? Remember that? Like, everybody, you know, like his dad that he went to find, he's on the naughty list, and everybody's just caught up in the clutter and the stress of just getting through the holidays. But here's Buddy the Elf, and man, he is pumped about Christmas. And you remember what he says when he's working in the department store, and you know, he makes that extravagant Lego world, and then he takes all those light brights and makes all this decoration. You remember what he says in that time of why he's so excited? Because Santa is coming and I know him. You know, and it made me think of all the clutter and all the stress, and yet I know Christ, the one who came and the one who's coming again. And the fact that we know him should cause us to be full of joy at Christmas. And not just Christmas, of course, but all the time, right? But just, you know, get that picture, those green tights, and I mean, he's so weird, and yet he's so excited when the rest of the world, remember there wasn't much Christmas spirit, and Santa's sleigh couldn't fly because of it, and you know, all that stuff, but it just reminded me as I was thinking on that of here's a guy that stood out to the whole world because he was so excited about Christmas, and it was because of who he knew. And we as Christians should be full of joy and excitement and anticipation of this day and this time and what we're celebrating as we gather with family and friends, as we come to church to worship the Lord. We should be full of joy because we know him and because he came and we are his. That should cause us to rejoice. Amen? And so we've looked at, just to recap for a moment, the first week we looked at the heart of Christmas. The heart of Christmas is worship. Every player in the Christmas story, all were glorifying, praising, and worshiping God. Every one of them. And so we looked at that. We looked at Mary and how she, you know, when she broke out into praise and worship of God and who he is and the things that he's done, she worshiped him. And then last week we looked at the Lord of Christmas, that God is the Lord God of Israel, the nation, and that God is the sovereign ruler of all nations of the universe. And if you remember from last week, just to recap for a moment, in verse 1 where it says Caesar Augustus, that was Gaius Octavius. And he, if you remember from last week, if you were here, he fought against Mark Antony and Cleopatra. Remember Cleopatra, the famed woman who could seduce any man? Well, she was married to Mark Antony. Mark Antony divorced Gaius Octavius's sister. He was married to her, divorced her for Cleopatra. So Caesar Augustus, Gaius Octavius, was not happy about that. And so Mark Antony, who was one of the rulers of Rome with Gaius Octavius, began to focus on Egypt because of Cleopatra. They got in a huge war, and Rome soundly defeated Egypt because Rome and Gaius Octavius had this great naval fleet, and they destroyed very easily the Egyptian force. And Gaius Octavius became the ruler, the sole ruler of Rome. And it was in his time and because of him that this census went out to the world. And that census is what got Mary and Joseph into Bethlehem at the right time so that she could have Jesus in Bethlehem according to Micah 5:2. There's nothing in the Bible that says Mary and Joseph thought, you know, we're having the Messiah, we should hurry up and get to Bethlehem so we can fulfill that prophecy. That wasn't in their mind. It's not in the scriptures. And I want to just remind you, as we think about what we're getting ready to look at, what God did to get this to happen the way it happened. And you know, when Jesus raised the dead, and God just takes his power and just breaks in and does something supernatural, that's pretty amazing. You know, I mean, when I go to a funeral and I look at a person laying in a coffin and I think Jesus just walked up and spoke and they got out of the coffin, that would be crazy amazing, wouldn't it? But you know what's even more amazing to me is over hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, as world leaders, the most powerful people in the world, like Caesar Augustus, like Mark Antony and Cleopatra, that God, as they lived their lives for themselves in total wickedness, and all the millions of people at that time, all through those hundreds of years, God moved as they lived their lives. God is orchestrating all the events for hundreds of years to get Mary and Joseph into Bethlehem just for those few days where the days would end for her pregnancy and she would give birth to Jesus, the Messiah, according to the Word of God. That is astounding, that all the people, all the rulers, everyone, all the events of history, God is orchestrating, working through those to fulfill His Word and His promise. That's astounding. And that's where we are here. If you look with me in verse 8 of Luke 2, we come to this place. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom He is pleased." When the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds began saying to one another, "Let us go straight to Bethlehem then and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And so today, as we've looked at the heart of Christmas, the Lord of Christmas, today we look at the gift of Christmas, God's gift to the world at Christmas. And so the announcement of the gift is verses 8 through 10. The angels come and they announce the birth of Messiah, that Christ has come. So here's the thing. Look with me in chapter 1 and verse 79. Zechariah is prophesying about Messiah's coming, and it says of Messiah that He will shine upon those who sit in darkness in the shadow of death to guide our feet into the way of peace. So consider what's happening here. The world sits in darkness, right? And if you're in darkness, have you ever been in a place that's so dark you can't see your hand in front of your face? You know, I remember there are times when I was a youth pastor and I'd go into the church late at night and like it's pitch black dark and it was creepy. Like it was like kind of scary. You felt like, is there somebody going to jump out behind a door and get me out here? Like, but there's something about darkness, right? But when it's dark, you can't see. And so the world, God says, is sitting in darkness and cannot see the light of the glory of God. And God intervenes. This is as this announcement is made, and this is so important, we can miss it because we've heard this story so many times. When the angels come and announce to the shepherds the birth of Messiah, the shepherds were not looking for the angels. The shepherds were not going, "When's Messiah coming? We know He's going to come soon." They were just going about their lives. Look at verse 8, what it says. The same region, there were shepherds staying out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. They were doing their job. They were just living their life. And God intervened. And God initiated this conversation with these shepherds to tell them of what was happening. And this is so important because a lot of people think, you know, like Benjamin Franklin was a deist, and he believed that, you know, God wound the world up and started it and just let it go, right? And there's a lot of people that are like that. They're deists, and they just believe God created things, and he wound it up real tight, and they just let it go, and he just sits back, and he has no involvement in the world, no involvement with people. And yet what we see right here as this begins with these angels coming is that God is he intervenes, he initiates a conversation, and he is highly involved in the lives of people on the earth. God does not wait for us to come to him. He came to us. And as the shepherds make this announcement, they would have never guessed that. They wouldn't have known where to go look. But God came to them and told them this good news. The world sits in darkness. Isaiah 9:2, this is a prophecy of what's happening here. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. If you've ever been hunting, you know, when you're sitting in the dark and you're waiting for the sun to come up, it's a glorious thing when all of a sudden everything is dark and you can't see, and the sun begins to rise, and the light begins to come into the forest, and you begin to see things. You're like, wow, I thought that was something else, and that is not what I thought it was. And then the animals begin to wake, and things begin to stir. And that's what's happening here. The people have sat in darkness, and now the light is shining. And God tells us this, that mankind is dead to God. We're in darkness. And that's in Romans 3. If you look on the screen with this passage, it says, as it is written, there's none righteous, not even one. There's none who understands. There's none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good. There is not even one. And so God says, there's none who seek after him. There's no one good. You know, if I compare myself to you or you compel yourself to me, you can go, well, I'm definitely good compared to that guy. But when we compare ourselves to God, God says none of us is good. And we sit in darkness and we are dead to him because of our sin. Ephesians 2, and you were, he's speaking to the Ephesians church, talking of their former life, you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them, we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Have you ever driven by and seen roadkill? Right? If you got out of your car and you walked up to, you know, November and December, there's deer everywhere dead on the roads, right? I know some of you have hit some of those deer, right? And so if you walk up to an animal that's dead on the road and you kick it, is it going to get up and bite you? Good answer. I love kids, I tell you what. Thank you for answering my question, right? So it won't, because it's what? Dead. When it's dead, it can't respond to anything. And that's what's happening. The world has sat in darkness. The world is dead to God. It cannot find him because it's in darkness. And God intervenes and he sends the angels to tell the shepherds of what is happening. There hasn't been any angels for over 400 years. And then one speaks to Zacharias, Gabriel, and then Mary. And now here's this angel speaking to the shepherds. And here's the thing. God doesn't wait for us. He comes after us because he loves us. What a great God. And he comes to the lowly shepherds. Isn't this is pretty amazing when you think about it. These shepherds were the lowest class in society. We'll talk more about them tonight. But the shepherds were low class scum. They were outcasts. They were nobodies. And here God is bringing the Messiah who's been promised for thousands of years, the one who's going to save the world from our sins. And he goes to a bunch of shepherds. Like, does God not know that he needs to go to the influential people that have a platform? I mean, isn't that what we say today? Oh, if that professional football or basketball player, if they'd come to Christ, you know, or that Hollywood star, they'd have such a platform. God doesn't do that. God came to the nobodies, the outcasts, and he told them the most important message that mankind will ever know. He entrusted it with them. With these nobodies. And, you know, and as we think about Jesus was born, you know, in a cave or a stable, he's laid in a feed trough. You know, that's how the shepherds, that's what the angels tell him, how you can identify him. When you go to Bethlehem, you'll see a little baby laying in a feeding trough. Like, that wasn't normal. Okay, just in case you didn't know that. That wasn't normal to walk and see a baby lying in a feed trough. And so that's how they would recognize it. All babies were swaddled with cloths back then, but they weren't all laid in a feed trough. And so here's the King of Kings who's laid in a feed trough. And the angels of God go to shepherds and tell them the story. Like, what is the deal with God? Like, doesn't he know that he should have gone to the powerful and the elite? But he goes to the nobodies. And his son comes in a way that is a nobody. I mean, he was born to a poor family. We know that from Luke 2 later. Mary and Joseph were poor. We know that. And he's laid in a feed trough. And so if you think about it, like back then, think about today. When you go to a hotel or a motel, what's outside every hotel and motel? A parking lot, right? So what were the cars they drove back then? They were animals. So outside of every inn, there was a what? There was a stable or a cave or something where they kept the animals. It was the parking lot. And so there's no room in the inn, and so Mary and Joseph are in the parking lot. That's where they had Jesus. I mean, isn't that crazy? And yet, do you see that when Christ came, I mean, it was the tax collectors, the sinners, the prostitutes were the ones that came to him. His disciples were nobodies. They were tax collectors that were despised by the Jews. They were fishermen. They were just regular old people, just nobodies. And do you see that as God came to earth, he brings the message to those who aren't looking for it, and he goes to those who are just nobodies, and we see that Christ Messiah can identify. He didn't just come to identify with the powerful and elite. He came to identify with you and me and with everyone else, whether you are a beggar on the street or whether you're a king in a palace, Jesus Christ is Lord and Messiah. And so he comes to these to show that he is the Savior of all men. And it's not about what kind of money you have or power or prestige you have or what you've been through in your life. None of that matters. None of that gives you any favor with God. We're all on the same playing field. And so notice what it says here in verse 9. An angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. The glory of God, the Shekinah glory of God. You remember in the Old Testament where the glory departed, Ichabod, was written across the temple because the glory of God had departed from Israel. It shows up here. And as the angel comes and speaks to the shepherd, the glory, the Shekinah glory of God is surrounding the angel, and the shepherds are seeing that. You remember when Moses saw some of God's glory? That his face became so bright that they had to put a veil over his face because you couldn't look at him. His face was so bright. And God's glory has come back to the earth because Christ is here. And the glory shines around them. And notice they're not like, oh, wow, it's the glory of God. That's cool. They're in fear. They're in terror because there's an angel and the glory of God is shining. And when anyone came into the presence of God, it brought fear and trembling. And so we see that as we're looking at this and considering God bringing this message. Look at Luke 14:11. This is a principle of all of Scripture. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. So consider, as the angels come to the shepherds, who is God, by this passage, who is God always going to use, go to and use in this life? Is he going to use those who have power and prestige, or is he going to use those who are humble? Everyone who exalts himself, God will humble them. He will oppose them. But everyone who is humble, God will exalt them. And here's these lowly shepherds. They're lowly. They're nobodies. God exalts them by giving them the greatest message ever. And as the glory of God comes back to the earth, they are the ones that see it first. Pretty amazing stuff, just as we consider what God is doing. And notice on this announcement, what do the angels tell the shepherds? Verse 10, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. And so the angels come, and the angel comes to the shepherds to tell them that he's bringing good news of great joy. This is the greatest news that has ever come to mankind. So think about good news. So next year, around November, when Ohio State plays Michigan, if Ohio State finally wins, right, will that be good news? And what will everybody be doing after that game's over? They'll be full of joy and excitement, and they'll be telling people, right? So the angel comes and says, I have greater news than Ohio State Michigan game. I have the greatest news the world has ever known and will ever know. And so as he brings this good news to the shepherds, this good news is to bring what? Joy. So again, consider as we're with all the clutter and all the stress of life in this time of year, and then you gotta get, have you ever gotten that kind of post-Christmas depression like in January? It's like, man, it's over, done, this stinks. I gotta wait a whole nother year for Christmas to be all anxious and worried again, right? Go figure. But this news of Messiah, of what he's getting to say to the shepherds, is to bring great joy. Good news always brings joy. And notice it says for all the people. This is something you may not have heard before. All the people in the Greek, it's the word the laity. And it's a group of people. This is not talking about here, all the nations. When the angel says to the shepherds, this will be for all the people, he's talking about Israel, the nation. And consider, just consider how this works. When Jesus began his ministry, who did he go to? It wasn't any Gentiles. Zero. He would not go to a Gentile. He went to Jerusalem. He went to the Jews. And when everywhere he went, remember when the one lady comes who has the disease and she wants to be healed? And he says that he's only come for the Jews, for Israel. And then that's when she says, but even the dogs eat the crumbs from the master's table. And Jesus goes ahead and heals her. But there was only a couple of Gentiles that Jesus even healed or spoke to, worked with. It wasn't until John 12, as Jesus approaches the cross, that the message begins to move to the Gentiles. And so here, when the angels say this to the shepherds, all the people, that's talking about Israel first. But I want you to see that good news cannot be contained, correct? Or can it? What do you do with good news? You take it and you share it, right? Look at Luke 2, verse 29. Now, Lord, Simeon. Now, Lord, you're releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation. Who's that? That's Jesus, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples. That is plural. When the angel in the earlier in Luke 2 speaks to the shepherd, it's people singular. It's a group. It's Israel. That's who Jesus came to first. Remember when Paul started his ministry? Who did he always go to first? The Jews. Okay? But notice what Simeon says here, but it's not going to stop there. It's going to continue to spread to all peoples. And he defines what that is in the next verse. A light of revelation to who? the Gentiles and the glory of your people, Israel. So Messiah is the glory of the people of Israel, and it was given to them first. But good news cannot be contained, and it spread to the Gentiles, which was always part of God's plan. Isaiah 49:6, we see this. This has always been God's plan. He says, "Is it too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to preserve the and to restore the preserved ones of Israel? I will also make you a what? Light of the nations, so that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth." Do you see? We saw this last week. You see it again today. You have the nation of Israel. They were first. Jesus came to them first, but the good news spread, as was always the plan of God from Isaiah. We see this to us, the Gentiles. And we see this as Jesus says this in Acts 1:8. Remember after the resurrection, what he tells the disciples? "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, and then Judea and Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the earth." Good news cannot be contained. It was never meant to be contained. It's always been God's plan to start with Israel, and then it would go out to the nations. And you and I are here today because right here in Luke 2, the gospel, the good news that the angel tells the shepherds did not stay there, but it went out. And it has spread over 2,000 years over all the earth. And today we continue to celebrate what we're looking at here because you cannot contain good news. It has spread. Think about that. This message, what you're looking at today, has spread for over 2,000 years. Over every culture, every language. You know, the Bible is the most translated book in all the history of mankind. There's not another book that's even close. Not only the most translated, it's the most hated book of all time as well. And it's actually also, this might be a little tidbit of trivia for you, it's also the most stolen book of all time. Figure that one. I'm going to steal the Bible. Go figure, right? And so think about, as the angels come, they announce to these nobodies, the shepherds, they're bringing this good news, and right from the beginning, this good news will never be contained. It's not going to stop with just Israel. It's going to continue. But isn't it amazing, at least it's amazing to me, that God's plan is for this message to spread over thousands of years to all the nations, and the first people he's going to tell are some shepherds. That's so amazing. But doesn't that show you that if it wasn't for God, this would never have gotten out of the stable, right? Because this is of God, because this is what God had ordained and he would make all of this happen, because it's his work and his plan, he could give it to some lowly shepherds and know that it would spread to the nations even 2,000 years later. Pretty amazing. So that's the announcement. And then we see the gift in verse 11. Here's the actual gift of Christmas. "For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord." This verse 11, this is the key of the whole passage. Of verse 1 through 20 of Luke 2, this is the key passage of the whole thing. "For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Christ the Lord. What does Savior mean? I mean, did Jesus come to save us from a bad self-esteem? Did he come to save us from a really bad job or a bad government or bad circumstances? I mean, if you think about saving someone, it's a rescuer, right? And a lot of people look, they like the Jesus in the manger, right? In the feeding trough. They like little baby Jesus that doesn't dictate their life. But the angel doesn't say that baby Jesus is coming and he's going to stay that way. He says, this is the Savior, Christ the Lord. Christ, Jesus came to save. Over 100 times in the Old Testament, God is known as God my Savior. Remember what Mary said in Luke 1. She said, God, my Savior. Look in Luke 1 what Zechariah said in verse 49. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of David. The Messiah was always meant to be a Savior. He came to save, but he didn't come to save from a bad self-esteem. He didn't come to save you from a bad economy so you could have your best life now. That's not why he came. He came in Matthew 1. We see this. Could you bring up the Matthew 1 passage? Now, this is what they told Joseph, the angel. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Why? He will save his people from what? Their sins. Now, all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. And Joseph awoke from his sleep and did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took Mary as his wife, but kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Why Jesus? Jesus means Yeshua. Yahweh saves. Jesus' very name told who he was and what he came to do. Yahweh saves. He came to save us from our sins. That's the only reason. Now, when you are saved from your sins, it changes your life, right? And it can change your self-esteem, and it can change all kinds of things. But Christ did not come for world peace. He did not come to save us from a bad government. He came to save us from our sins. Because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're the Pope or Mother Teresa. We have all sinned against a holy God. We've all lied and stolen and lusted and been angry. I mean, Jesus said in Matthew 5, if you hate your brother or you call someone an idiot, you're in danger of hell. Right? We've all done that. If we're honest, we sinned against God. And that's why Jesus came. Jesus is a Savior to save you and me and those of the world from our sins. Because the wages of sin brings death. And what comes after death? In Hebrews 9:27, we have that one out there? There it is. I'm skipping around, so Pastor Reed's doing a good job. And as much as it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes what? Judgment. There's no reincarnation, right? There's no purgatory. It's appointed for us to die once, and after this comes judgment. When we've sinned against a holy God, which God says all of us have, there's none good, not even one. And when we die, which... how many people live forever? I mean, how many people out of 10 die? You know, sometimes I think people think it's like 5.3 or 6 out of 10. Like, we know 10 out of 10 people die. And the Bible says because we've all sinned, we're all going to die. And the moment we pass through this life, we will stand before God in judgment. We see that in Luke 16, right? The rich man and Lazarus. There was a man. That is a fact that will happen. The moment our life ends, we will stand before God. There is a day of reckoning. And Christ came to save us from that. Because it doesn't matter who you are. I mean, I'm a pastor. Ask my family. I sin. I mess up. I struggle. There's no one who doesn't. And if somebody says, oh, I've never lied, then they're lying, right? That's what I ask people. Have you ever lied? Oh, no, I've never lied. Well, okay, you're lying. So just go ahead and raise your hand now, right? I mean, because if we're honest, we realize we all fall short. We can't compare ourselves to God. We'll never measure up. And that's why God sent a Savior. He didn't send Jesus to just come and rule the first time. Jesus is going to come back and rule, but he sent him to save us from our sins. He is a Savior. And we saw that in Matthew 1, in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 3, it says, "Now make to known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, and which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for what? Our sins, according to the Scriptures." The angel is saying, shepherds, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for you. A Savior has been born. The Savior came to save us from our sins. And God came to rescue us. Look at Ephesians 2. This is such a great passage. We looked at the first three verses. You were dead in your trespasses and sins, which you formerly walked according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that's now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature, our nature was children of wrath, even as the rest. But now look, here's the two greatest words, I think, in all the Bible. Our nature was children of wrath. We were dead in our sins, but God... God, just like here, he intervenes. We were dead in our sins, and he came after us. He didn't wait for us to come to him because we're dead in our sins. We're children of wrath. And even as enemies of God, he came after us because he loves us. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. I mean, God sent a Savior. And because we were dead in sin, because we could not save ourselves, he came to rescue us from our sins and God's judgment that is coming. Awesome. But who is the Savior? Verse 11, Christ the Lord. Christ means Messiah. When you see Christ, that's the word, it's Messiah. And Messiah is the anointed one. And we see this in Daniel 9 and in other places where it speaks of the anointed one, and that's Messiah. Kings are anointed. Remember Saul and David in the Old Testament? What did Samuel come up and do? He anointed them to be king, right? The anointed one, the King of Kings, is Christ. He is the Savior who is Christ, Messiah, the anointed one, the King of Kings. Revelation 19 tells us this. And I saw heaven open, behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is faithful and true. In righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, many crowns. Those are crowns of kings that he's defeated. And he has a name written on him which no one else knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. This is Jesus. And the armies which in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword so that with it he may strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, and he treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This Savior who is being born right here is that guy, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the Messiah, God with us, God incarnate. This is no just baby. This is the King of all kings, the one who is sovereign ruler over all time and space and eternity. He has come to save us. That's awesome. Man, if that doesn't light your insides on fire and stir you up, your wood's wet. Amen? I mean, praise God, right? I mean, we've heard this so many times, but get back in your mind and your heart that the King of Kings, who rules the universe, he is here in Luke 2 being born as a baby because he's come to rescue you from your sins. That is awesome. And he is Christ, the King. He is Christ. Messiah was not only King. We see in Hebrews that he's the high priest and he's a prophet. He is the one who is high priest, king, and prophet, Jesus, the Savior. But we also see that he's Lord. This is a divine title. In the Greek, the word Lord here is the Greek word used for God in the Old Testament, Yahweh. Consider this. It's the word Lord here, where it says Christ the Lord, is the word kurios, which means supreme power, authority, sovereignty with legitimacy, validity, lawfully. It's not something Jesus earned to become Lord. It's who he was, who he is in his being. He is Lord, supreme power, authority, and sovereignty. In the Greek Old Testament. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew. When they translated the Old Testament from Hebrew to Greek, they used this word, kurios, Lord, and it's used 6,156 times in the Old Testament for Jehovah, Yahweh, God. Jesus is not a Lord. He's not a God. He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is Yahweh, Jehovah, in the flesh. That's awesome. This God came to save us. And just consider, as you look at the Old Testament, where it says, God, my Savior, when it's speaking of the Lord God, Jehovah, being Savior, it's the same word here. Jesus is Yahweh, the Lord saves. Yahweh saves. He is the God of the Old Testament who has entered into time and space to rescue us. This is so awesome and amazing to think of what is going on here, that what God is doing because of his great love for us. And here's what's so awesome. Look back at verse 11. This Savior, Christ the Lord, has been born for who? For you. I mean, think about that. Here's the angel. This Jesus, Savior, Messiah, God incarnate, Emmanuel, God with us, has been born for you. Not just the world, he's been born for you. Now, I remember a day that I was praying and I was so consumed and just devastated with my sin. Just in the depth of not outward sin, but inside. You know, the Pharisees, they were clean on the outside, but man, inside, Jesus said, you're full of death, right? A lot of times we try to make the outside look good, but inside, we're messed up. And I remember just the weight of my sin, and I was on my face just saying, God, have mercy on me, because I knew if God gave me justice, I'd be in hell. And as I'm crying out to God for mercy, the light comes on that Christ died for my sins. Not the world. He died for mine. And that's what the angel, that Christ the Lord is a personal Savior. He didn't just come to rule the world. Here he's coming to save each one of us. To come to us, that we must respond to Christ as our personal Savior. Not just do you believe facts about Jesus, but have you realized, have you come to the place where you've seen that you can't save yourself and you need a Savior? And that Savior is Christ the Lord. And he came and he died and rose again for you. That's what the angel said, isn't it, to the shepherd? And in Simeon, he's going to light to the Gentiles. And he's the Savior of all mankind. There is no one else. There's not Buddha and the Pope and all these other religions. Those are all false. There's only one Savior, and it's Jesus Christ the Lord. Why? Because he's God. Because he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He owns everything. He rules the universe. There is no other Savior. But that God came into time and space to rescue you, to be your personal Lord and Savior, where you have to see your sin, repent, and put your trust personally in him to save you from your sins. It's not enough to just believe that he came into the world, he's some baby in a manger. It's not enough to just go, yeah, he died on the cross and rose again. Is he your Savior? David said in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. Mary said in Luke 1, God, my Savior. Not a Savior, not the Savior, my Savior. Is Christ your Savior? Do you know him? Like Buddy the Elf, I know him. Do you know Christ? Or is it just some belief, some religious thing? That's so boring. I mean, Christianity religion is so boring, dull, and just yuck. It's Christ. And when you know Christ, Christianity is an adventure. Because when you follow Jesus, he's taking you to some crazy places where you have to live by faith. Do you know him? Is he your personal Savior? He has come for you. And the angel says in verse 12, here's the sign. You'll find this baby wrapped in cloths lying in a feed trough. And this is what we see in John 1:14. The Word became flesh and what? Dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory. Glory is of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word, remember Revelation 19? His name was the Word of God, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He came and he dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. You remember on the Mount of Transfiguration, Peter and John, three guys are up there, and Jesus just pulls back his flesh and his glory, the Shekinah glory of God comes out, right? And they're like, whoa, this is who this guy is. This is who came to save us. He came to live among us so that he could save us, he could rescue us. As we spoke before, he didn't come for the elite and powerful. Jesus was the friends of tax collectors and sinners. I mean, if that doesn't encourage you, I don't know what will. God doesn't care how much money you got. He doesn't care about your bank account. He doesn't care about how great an athlete you are. He doesn't care about that. He was the friend of tax collectors and sinners. What God cares about is, will you humble yourself and come to him on his terms and allow him to use you for his purpose? That's what's so awesome. We're talking about God. It's so not the world, right? The world is you got to have power and fame and all this wisdom and knowledge and all these things. And God's showing us, I am the friend of sinners. And isn't that what he said in Luke chapter 5 and verse 31? Here's what he told the Pharisees. Not coming? Luke 5. Well, turn in your Bible there. I probably forgot to tell Pastor Reed to put that in there. Luke 5:31. I think I did because it's close. Here's what Jesus said to the Pharisees. It is not those who are well who need a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus came for those who could say, yeah, I'm sick. I need a doctor. And he came to call sinners to repentance. He didn't come for those who think they're all high and mighty. That's what he says in 1 Corinthians 1. The word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it's the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the cleverness of the clever I will set aside. Where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For indeed, Jews ask for signs and Greeks search for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to Jews a stumbling block and to Gentiles foolishness. But to those who are the call, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brethren. Now here's I want you to see this. Here's what Paul says to the Corinthian church. Consider your calling, brethren. There were not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble, as the world would see them. But God has chosen the foolish things. He's speaking of people. The people the world would see as foolish to shame the wise. God has chosen the ones the world sees as weak to shame the things that are strong. And the base things of the world and the despised, God has chosen the people that are despised in the world's eyes. God has chosen them, the things that are not, that he might nullify the things that are, so that no man may boast before God. But by his doing, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. So that just as is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. Amen. Aren't you glad that Jesus didn't come just for the high and mighty? I mean, you remember what he said about the high and mighty? It's easier for the camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And he's taken the ones, I mean, think about his disciples. Think about the ones that God has used through time and eternity. They haven't been the powerful elite. They've been the nobodies. Why? Who gets the glory when a nobody does something that could only be of God? God does. God uses us, the just regular old people that the high and mighty don't see. He uses us because he gets the glory. It's evident, and it's evident to us, this isn't me, this is him. And so as we think about this whole thing of Christ coming and being born and laid in a feeding trough and being born to poor family with no money, with no platform, no prestige, And the message is given to shepherds. We see that God does not do things the way the world does. He doesn't care about the things the world thinks are great. God came, and he came like this to be your Savior if you will repent and trust in him. And we see that he came for us and that he's the only Savior in Acts 4:12. Peter and John said this, there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. There's only one Savior. It's Christ the Lord and no one else. And then finally, just as we close here, the response to the gift. What does heaven do? And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. The word here, heaven rejoices. And I want you to picture this. Consider the whole sky, as far as you can see, fills up with angels. And angels are so scary. When you see one, you're in terror. They don't look like women with big wings or some, you know, little chubby kids with, you know, bows and arrows. These are powerful beings. Just to see one of them is awesome. The sky literally fills with angels. The word multitude here, And as we look at what Revelation speaks of these myriads upon myriads, the Greek word is myrion, and it means thousands of thousands times thousands of thousands times 10,000. It says myriads of myriads times 10,000. So it's a in the word myrion in the Greek was the highest number, like we would say infinity. That's what it's talking about. The sky literally fills with millions. Don't talk to me. My watch is talking to me, sorry. The sky literally fills with millions of these angels. And what are they doing? They are rejoicing. They are praising God, worshiping Him. Look again what it says. This multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom He is pleased." And so they're bringing glory to God. Why? Well, it tells us in Luke 15. Remember the story of the lost coin, the lost sheep, and the lost son? I tell you, in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. And then the next verse, this is about the lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. And then of the lost son, the father says to the other son, who is mad at his younger brother because they're giving him a party, the father says, "We had to celebrate and rejoice, for this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live. He was lost and has been found. Why are the angels rejoicing? Because the Savior has come for us. And there's only one thing in the Bible that we see that heaven rejoices in. It's when a sinner comes to repentance. When one comes to repentance and they put their full trust in Christ and they're born again, heaven rejoices. There is literally a party in heaven. That's what it says. And here, because the Savior has finally come, Christ the Lord, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, has entered time and space to save us, the angels break forth into praise. Isn't that awesome? I mean, what an awesome God. And all the angels, Hebrews 1 tells us angels are to help God's people. And here the angels are glorifying God because He's fulfilled His word. He's kept His promise, and Messiah has come to save us from our sins. And notice how in verse 15, what do the shepherds do? Let's go see what He just told us. They act on the word of God. They hear what God says and they respond. And I want you to consider today, we've heard this story maybe a million times, right? But I want you to consider in your own life, have you ever acted upon the gospel? That Christ, the Lord, God, entered time and space, He is the one Savior. There is no one else. And He came to save you, each of you, from your sins, because there is a day of reckoning that will come as soon as you're gone. As soon as you step through the door of death, you will face God. And God is not somebody you walk up to and go like Mr. Rogers. You know, oh yeah, you know, he sits down, puts on a nice sweater and changes his shoes and just this soft, nice guy. That's not who He is. He is the creator of the universe. He holds the stars in place. You know, the sun, that's a star. It's 70,000 degrees inside in its core. He holds that in His hand. He holds them in place. He keeps gravity working. He holds all things together. This is the God. When you step through the door of death into eternity, you will face Him. And have you acted upon what God has done? He came into this world. He didn't stay a baby. He went to a cross. And He died to pay for your crimes and to pay for mine. Mine that would pile up to the heavens, literally. He came and died for my sins. That's what I told you earlier. When I realized not the outward things. I mean, I grew up in the church. I didn't do that many terrible things on the outside. But I was dead on the inside. And He came and He showed me the depth of my sin. And that I needed a Savior. And I acted on it. I realized before God I had nothing to offer Him. I had nothing good. There was nothing I could say to God, look at this, and be pleased with me. There was nothing. And he came to, and he died on a cross to pay for my crimes, to rescue me, not from a bad self-esteem, to rescue me from himself and the judgment that is coming. And then he didn't just die, he rose again the third day. He came, who can die and raise themselves? But didn't Jesus say, I'm going to lay down my life and I will take it up again? And he is the one who came and died and rose again, King of kings and Lord of lords. Have you acted on it? Have you come all the way to Jesus? Not did you pray some prayer. There's nothing in the Bible that says pray a prayer and be saved. It's not there. Have you seen your sin, who he is, and realized I am in big trouble if God gives me justice? I need a Savior. And humbled yourself and said, Lord, I need mercy. I need you to rescue me. And you've come all the way to Christ by faith and given him your life. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says you must confess Jesus as Lord, as God, and as the sovereign ruler of your life. Not something you attach on the side, not something you go to and, you know, sit in a chair and listen to somebody speak and sing some songs. Not something you just believe in your head. He is the sovereign ruler of all things. And each of us must come to him and turn our lives over to him and allow him to be the sovereign ruler of our personal life. Have you acted like the shepherds? They didn't wait. It says immediately they responded to the message from God. Have you done that? Have you in your personal life come all the way to Christ? And if you have, what do the shepherds go on to do? To go and tell. Amen? Will you go and tell the good news? You're here if you know Christ because somebody 2,000 years ago went and told the good news. And it has spread to us so that we can be saved. Will you go and tell? Will you act on the word of God, the good news that cannot be contained, and tell someone this Christmas of the great love of God in Jesus Christ? Will you go and tell? This is just an overflow of our heart, right? If you're full of exceeding joy, what are you going to do with it? You're going to tell somebody, right? Let's tell someone of the great love of God in Jesus Christ this Christmas. Man, I've been praying all week, Lord, help us to see this chapter just like we've seen it for the first time, because it's so cluttered with hearing it so many times. But come again this Christmas. Think again of what God has done for you, that God came because he loves you. But if you reject him, it will literally be hell to pay. But he came to save you from that because he cares. He loves us. And he did all of this to save us. The band's going to come up now in the choir. We have a choir today. Yeah. And we're going to sing these last songs. And as they come, I want you to consider today, as we sing these songs, consider what these songs are saying. Try to stay focused as they're walking up. I know it's hard. But we got to get everybody up here, right? Try to focus on, as we're singing these songs, who he is, what he's done, and worship him because he's worthy. Amen? Amen. Hope you all have a very Merry Christmas. Wonderful time celebrating that he has come. Amen. Christ the Lord, God incarnate. What a mighty God. What an awesome Savior. Let's pray, and I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful Christmas celebration. Lord, we praise you, Lord, that you came. Lord, we worship you, that you are God incarnate, and you came to save us. Christ the Lord, and we just praise you for the great, amazing love that you have shown and displayed to us, Lord, not just coming, but dying and rising again. And God, I pray that we would be as a shepherd today and we would act upon your word. God, as you have spoken in each of our hearts, Lord, help us to have heard and help us to respond. And Lord, I pray that our Christmas celebration this year will be full of joy and wonder and praise to you, the one true God. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Merry Christmas.